high school and 9:05 start time for elementary school. That means that we have a little over 700 routes. We have 660 bus drivers every single day. So we start, before we really look at absences, we start a good 50 to 60 bus drivers short, meaning we have to do double and triple runs. The current bus drivers have to circle back multiple times to get other routes. What's that mean for what's actually happened in our schools? First and foremost, it means kids have had to show up very early to school. So in our high schools and middle schools today, we have students arriving as early as 6:30 in the morning. Not only is that negative for the students, but it's also negative for the staff. They have to be supervised at 6:30 in the morning. So many of our administrators and support personnel are showing up at 6:30 in the morning. It also means, as we circle back, that students are showing up late to school. So we have students every single day who miss anywhere from 15 minutes to 2 hours of instruction because of our bus shortage. Then in the afternoon, and the same thing happens with elementary. Then in the afternoon, we have students staying as late as 5:30 p.m. in some of our middle and high schools. So we have students who are being supervised because of our bus shortage from 6:30 a.m. to about 5:30 p.m. And the same goes for our elementary schools. This is unfair to the students. It's unfair to the staff who have to deal with this. And to be clear about numbers, we have had nearly 20,000 students who have missed instructional time during the 22-23 school year up to now as a result of our transportation issues. And I will say again, this is not just us, this is a nationwide issue, but it's something we have to deal with. We have lost nearly 3 million minutes of instruction for our students of those 20,000 because of our bus transportation. That does not even include students who may not have come to school because their bus didn't show up. These are students who were late to school. So first and foremost, I have to say, doing the same thing next year is not an option for us. We have to do something different. Doing nothing means we would end up with the same problems next year and quite possibly a worse situation next year, whether that's continued decline of bus drivers or the increase in routes we will have next year as a result of our, we'll be working on two student assignment plans. So next year we would be above 800 routes if we keep the same bus drivers we have. And I will say this, we are constantly recruiting bus drivers, but the data here and the data nationally does not show that we will see an increase in bus drivers, and probably will not see any time in the near future that increase as well. This is a problem in every transportation sector and many of sectors across employment. And so this is just not us, but we don't see a change coming anytime soon. So it is incumbent on us to make that change. With the additional routes and the start times, with the additional start times that we are adding, going from 2 to 9 start times, we will actually reduce our bus routes to 600. That is with both the new student assignment plan and the grandfathered student assignment plan that we have. If we keep our 650 bus drivers, or more that we continue to add, what this means is that we actually now have enough bus riders for every route. We eliminate double and triple routes. Kids will get to school an average of 14 minutes before the start of school. They will leave at the latest 14 minutes after school. We'll eliminate all of our triple runs. Most, if not all, of our double runs will be eliminated. Therefore, this is the answer for our transportation issues. This solves the problem. This ensures that every student is picked up. This plan actually ensures a shorter time on the bus for our students, from an average of 29 minutes to 27 minutes. This is not adding substantial number of students to each bus. So it is solving the problem that we need to have solved. It is impacting positively students to make sure that they get to school on time and are there for every class. And it also makes sure that our staff is not having to supervise kids for 11 hours every single day. At Stewart Middle School this afternoon, there will be several hundred students waiting in the gym for buses to come back and get them. That's unfair to those students, and it's unfair to the staff of that school. We have to make a change. And so when I say we have to make a change, we could also look at some other alternatives, like other districts have done, which is to eliminate transportation unless it is a reside school. So magnets would not receive transportation. We only provide transportation to our reside schools. Free and reduced lunch students may be the only students who receive transportation. This is what other large districts are doing across the nation. We did not want to take those steps. We want to make sure every single student in Jefferson County has transportation to their schools. But we also have what our consultants noted as probably the most accommodating transportation system in the United States, with the shortest door to bus stop, from the student's door to their bus stop, of being an average of 0.14 miles, which is just a little over a city block, to making sure every student has the same bus in the morning and afternoon. That adds about, it's called mirroring, adds about 20% routes to our total system, to making sure that every student gets transportation to nearly any school that they want to attend. There are a few exceptions about that, but we provide transportation to nearly every student, and we want to continue to do that. So first and foremost, the why of this and how we get to next year, these 9 start times completely solve our issues around transportation. I can't say that clearly enough. If we do nothing, I'll be standing in front of you next year talking about delayed buses, students missing instructional time, staff having to stay after school. That is a definitive. There is no doubt about that. If we do this plan, then that will not be a story that you all will be covering next year. Secondly, I want to talk about later start times. As I said, when I went back to my State of the District address in 2020, I talked about how important it was for adolescent students, specifically grades 6 through 12, to start later. You would be hard-pressed to find a child psychologist, a pediatrician, who would debate that need. Our students right now, 6 through 12, for many, many years, arrive at school at 7:40 in the morning. That means many of them are catching a bus as early as 6:15 in the morning. Research is clear. This is not healthy for our students. Right now, it is negatively impacting attendance throughout JCPS. If we just take our reside schools, the vast majority of 6 through 12 schools that we are looking to change time to an hour later, right now, 45% of that student population, middle and high school, is chronically absent, meaning they are missing 18 or more school days a year. There is no way students or our schools can be successful improving student outcomes if a student is missing 18 or more school days a year. Now, there's a multitude of factors that go into that. That is not just about start time, but research is clear. Early start time negatively impacts student attendance. So our neediest students, nearly 37,000 students in these schools, are going to school every morning at 7:40 a.m., meaning they start school or they wake up in the morning 6:15 every single morning. Coupled with our student assignment plan, if those students, many of them, miss the bus, they have no opportunity to get to school. This is a recipe for disaster when it comes to student outcomes. And it is imperative for us to make a change and for everyone to recognize this. Let me be more clear about some research on this. Journal of School Health in 2022 said the following: later secondary school start times is a significant policy shift that not only improves the health and well-being of adolescents, but can also equalize sleep duration and minimize stress for teachers, as they also get to sleep as well. Further, a University of Washington study found that studying schools in Seattle, when they move back start times for middle and high school, students got on average 34 more minutes of additional sleep every night. Now let me be more specific what they said. Student sleep went from 6 hours and 50 minutes a night to 7 hours and 24 minutes a night. I think if you talk to pediatricians, they would say 724 is probably not enough. But we would all say for grade 6 through 12, 6 hours and 50 minutes of sleep is not adequate for our children. Here's what they said. The study found an improvement in grades and a reduction in tardiness and absences as a result of shifting start time. The study also showed a link between getting more sleep and positive academic performance. With this change, we will have approximately 30,000 of our highest need students, grades 6 through 12, now moving back an hour to 8:40. So the research is clear. It improves attendance, it improves the tardiness, it improves health and well-being of students, and it improves academic outcomes. When research says that, it's something we have to act on. You know, if we do not act on that, we are not doing our job. Several other states around the nation have already passed statewide laws that said middle and high schools can't start till after 8:30. And so I know California has done that, Tennessee is exploring that, many other states. We are taking this action because it is what is best for our students. So finally, I will say this. I know that changing start times for, you know, we have about 19 schools that aren't changing. We have 83% of these changes that are less than an hour. But I also know it is difficult for families to make changes. I'm a father. My daughter's a senior, so she won't be impacted by this. But I also know changing times is challenging. I know when she went from elementary school, starting at 9:05 to 7:40, that's a change. But this is what is right for students. This will positively impact students. The 20,000 students who are late to school will now be at school on time every single day. They will leave right after school. The 30,000 students that are getting an extra hour's sleep will improve attendance, will improve tardiness, and will improve academic outcomes. So the research is clear on this. This is a step we have to take because doing the same thing is not an option for us. I'm really pleased with this plan. I know it will be challenging to implement, but it's what is right for the students of Jefferson County. Happy to take any questions that you have. So our first and foremost goal with magnets, those schools that parents choose, you know, we want this to be a part of the process that parents choose. So first and foremost, it was our magnets. We have to have down to 600 bus routes. In a perfect situation, we would have all of our middle and high schools at 8:30. But coupled with the transportation issue, we have to get down to 600 routes. That was our cap. We told our consultants, Alpha Route, that we needed 600 routes. That would solve our transportation problem. So we knew it wasn't going to be impossible to get every school. Our focus was to try to get the choice schools, so a parent, when they are enrolling their child for middle or high school, they can say, do I want a 7:40 start time or an 8:40 start time? Every parent will have that choice. We have four or five middle and highs that are left that are at 7:40 that are reside school. Our goal will be to continue to work on efficiency and hopefully move them to 8:40 after 1 year. Can't guarantee that now, but that's what our goal is to do. But eventually what we want, inside of clusters for elementary schools, there's a multitude of start times. Middle and high, magnets and choice, you know, those that are saying, I've got to apply to go there, a parent will know that's an earlier start time. If I don't want that for my child, I can go to one of the reside school, which every parent has the right to go to. So really, we want the start time to be a part of the choice process as well, what works best for families.
For parents who have kids that are possibly
going to start school later at 9 or 10 a.m. and they have to go to work really early in the morning, what would you say to those parents who are concerned about how they're going to be getting their kids to school when they're already having kids? Yeah, well, what I'd say right now is many of those kids are arriving after 9:40 and they're staying until 5 and 6 o'clock at night. And so you could talk to any of these principals who are dealing with, and so the start, I've reiterated this, start time is actually when the kids show up and when they leave. And so whatever we put on the books and when the bell rings, we can say that's the start time, but that's when the students actually arrive and when they leave. And so we have kids arriving at 10 o'clock today to school and we'll be there till 5 or 6 o'clock at night. So first of all, that's actually our start and finish time. We've met with CEP. We're going to collaborate with them. We're obviously going to have to change CEP, so there may be some sites that have more intensive morning time, more hours for morning, and some for afternoon. That will be inside of every cluster. So CEP is going to be an important partner with this. But it's also important to know that if families need to, once again, we have multitude of start times within each of our clusters. So if a family just can't make it work and they have a 9:40 start time, now all K through 12 is 9:40 or earlier. So I want to reiterate that. There is not a K through 12 start time that is past 9:40. But if we need to, we'll work with families during the transfer time to get them to a school. Now, what our survey tells us is most families love their elementary school. And so I understand that they want to stay there. But if it just can't work and we can't get CEP to be a match, which we think we can, then we'll work with families to meet their needs.
Can you explain the CEP process, what that
would look like? Well, right now there's a location in every cluster. And so we transport from elementary schools if needed for, and it is available both in the morning before elementary school, I believe from 7 to 9 is CEP. And then it's also available after school from, I would say, 4 o'clock to 6 maybe is available. And so in every cluster, a family has an opportunity to use CEP for before care, for school care, after school care, and the Y that runs CEP does a fabulous job. And they're struggling with employees just like we are getting the number of employees, so that's a challenge that we'll have to overcome together. But what it, if so now, if a school starts early, a parent may not need CEP in the morning, but they may need it in the afternoon. And so we may have, depending on the cluster, going to, you know, more in the morning. But if it's a later start time, they may need CEP in the morning, but not the afternoon. So we're trying to balance that out so we can support all families. Well, I'll say it again, you know, once again, we're in a transportation crisis. And so it will not, if I move everyone that and we still have 750 routes, the kids will not be picked up, they'll miss instructional time. And there is no doubt the negative impact on student outcomes when they miss 3 million minutes of instructional time is immense. And so goal number one, let's be clear on this. Goal number one is to make sure every student arrives on time to school, you know, with the average time 14 minutes before classes start. They can have breakfast and go right to class. And then right after school, if they're not staying for extracurricular activities, they can leave right away. There's no double and triple runs. So that's goal number one, not miss instructional time and get them. So that's what we have to do. You know, I, in my opinion, as the leader of JCPS, have no option in we have to make that change. The other options are we continue to do what we're doing now, which is not an option for me. I want to say this. Continuing what we're doing is not an option. Or number two, we stop providing transportation to a large number of students. So that was our cap, 600 routes. This is how it had to fit in, where our goal is to improve efficiencies so that we can move those schools in the near future as well.
Do you have any idea if this goes into effect next year, how many families would have multiple children with multiple start times, and how many people would be affected by this?
I can't say I have a total number of multiple start times. I mean, most of our families have multiple start times right now. So if a family has an elementary child and a middle or high school child, they have multiple start times right now. You know, they have a 7:40 and a 9:05 start time. So I think that is something we have to do. And we really, guys, have to look at, you know, we have to look at what other districts are doing. I know change is hard. This change should have been done 15 or 20 years ago. But here we are right now dealing with the consequences of no change. When you look at almost any other district in the nation, they may have elementary starting early. They may have them spread out throughout. They have middle and high starting later. But the bottom line is they have 20, 30, 40 different start times. We're the 28th largest district in the United States that has 2 start times. That is built for a district that probably has 5, 6, 7,000 students. But it is what we have dealt with here over the past few years, which is trying to change the foundation of JCPS, the future state, because we've been doing the same thing we've been doing for 50 years. And so, yeah, I understand it's challenging and a multitude of start times, but this is the change that has to take place. So we have a system here called depots, so it's important to understand the depot system. The depot system is essentially, if a student is not going to their reside school, we transport them to a depot from their house. Depots are almost like the Atlanta airport, right? You fly in, and then you go to another plane and get on it and go wherever your final destination is. It's the same with our depots. And we have several of them, but students come into that, and they may be from a multitude of schools, and then they go to the bus that meets their school. We have one right behind us at about 2:45 today that will be doing that, bringing in, going on to other buses. So we have two depot times now. Obviously, any school that has a depot time is limited to now 3 weeks, because we have to have an hour in between. So if you're a school that has a depot student, any depot at all, it's either 7:40, 8:40, or 9:40. There are no other options in there. All the in-between times, which is what improved efficiency for us, are schools that only have direct runs in their clusters. And so we could then take the 20 to 30 schools that are on the different times other than 7:40, 8:40, and 9:40, because they're all direct runs. That increased efficiency for us when we talked about our routes. So we started with that. If you have it, which the vast majority of our schools are, depot runs, 7:40, 8:40, or 9:40. We wanted middle and high to be 7:40 or 8:40. Those were the two. We wanted 9:40, you know, the depot run for elementary. We really want elementary and middle and high schools to not be switching buses at a depot at the same time. And so that made an elementary depot run at 9:40. And so that was a big part of it. We also looked at our choice zone schools and our AIS schools and try to maximize our highest need schools that would start at 8:40 for middle and high and 9:40 for elementary in order to maximize attendance. So a part of it was also focusing on, you know, some support of our highest need schools. We were looking at AIS schools and our choice zone schools. Yeah, so most districts, if you start polling in the Commonwealth of Kentucky, and the law says, you know, it's like 1 to 2 miles based on age, and you will find most districts in around the country, they may not even go into a neighborhood. You know, the parent has to get them to the edge of the neighborhood, and that's where they'll pick them up. These are steps districts are taking across the nation. And so the more bus stops you have, the longer it is going to take to complete routes. I mean, it's just as simple as that. And so right now we are nearly providing door-to-door service. And so when we look at the data, it's the vast majority of our students, the vast majority of our bus riders will still be less than a quarter of a mile. So you're talking 2.5-3 city blocks is what we're doing. But if we're going to provide efficiencies and reduce routes, these are some of the steps we're going to have to take. Or the other option, once again, and let's continue to focus on what the other option would be, we stop providing transportation to all students. Well, it's not, I want to say this again, our consultant Alpha Route, which is a group that is primarily from MIT coders out of Boston who have done this with a multitude of districts across the nation. And I would be lying to you if I said I understood the algorithms and how they work. We tell them the guardrails we put on, that these are some of the parameters we want. We want transportation for all of our kids. We don't want an increase in buses, bus routes. You know, these are the numbers of routes we want. We don't want walk times past this. We want certain schools, like I said, our high need schools at certain times. And then they build a system with their algorithms that meets the needs to get us down to 600. And so in the end, it's a complicated formula that I can't explain. I would need some data scientists from MIT to come on here, and you probably wouldn't understand it, just like I didn't understand it when they told me. But what we also said was we wanted, like, okay, in a cluster, we need a multitude of times in each cluster. And so they built that based on the algorithms that they use with a multitude of districts that they work with. So sorry, I can't be more specific, but. To make it more efficient, correct. Yeah, I don't see. I've been asked that question about especially high school extracurriculars. I don't see that being an issue. We finish at 320. Actually, as a former coach, I would probably appreciate that more. It's less time in between the end of school and games that you're watching the kids and waiting to load the bus to go there or have a game or practice. So, you know, I would appreciate that. And I would say, you know, let's look at the districts around us. I think Oldham County finishes at 4 o'clock every day, and somehow they still continue to have extracurricular activities, and we play them in athletics. So it may require a slight adjustment to some of the sports, but I just don't think sports or extracurricular activities are going to be an issue because our latest high school and middle schools finish at 320. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, that won't change at all. Yeah, so what we're going to do, obviously, we're collecting feedback, and we understand, I clearly understand we are listening and hearing, and I knew going into this it wasn't going to be easy. I knew we were going to, you know, that change is hard. I'd ask the community and everyone to look at this from a collective perspective of 96,000 students and how our students are being impacted negatively right now. And so, you know, if we're going to be successful as a community, I think we have to look at our district as a whole and say these are 96,000 students in our community. Yesterday, I spoke at a convening that many of you covered on youth violence and disconnected youth. You know, disconnected youth, one of the number one factors in disconnected youth is school attendance. We get kids to school more often, get them connected to school, the likelihood they're going to be successful dramatically improves. So this is one of our things. We got to improve attendance. But we're going to get feedback. We understand. The hard part about this is like a giant puzzle. So it's not easy just to move one school around. But we are going to get feedback. We're going to have some town hall meetings. We're going to have at least a couple of sessions with our board, public sessions to discuss and answer questions. This is something that we'll have to move pretty quickly. This will have to be in front of our board for a vote by mid to late March. I would think spring break at the latest. Because this is implementing in August. So some people say, you know, why not wait a year to do it? Why not pass it and have 1 year where people have time to adjust? I'll say this again. Doing nothing means we have the problem that we have right now and worse. Doing nothing means that, which means 20,000 kids missing instruction, a total of 3 million minutes. It's just not an option for us. So we anticipate a vote by mid to late March so that we can implement it for the first day of school. Not yet. I mean, we'll have it well in advance. You can see on our board agenda when our board meetings are. That will be released well in advance for families. Yeah, sure. I mean, we work with JCTA and our other union partners for all of our employees to share this with them and to work on ways that we can support. So once again, within clusters, you know, we have a variety of start. I think elementary will be the biggest change from what we see. So, you know, I think From what we've seen, most middle and highs will be able to, you know, work either 740 or 840, but I know the elementary is a big change for folks. And so we are working with JCTA to say, all right, first of all, the transfer window is still open, so, and really hasn't opened yet, excuse me. So teachers have time right now to look and see what school, if this doesn't work for me, what's a school that I would like to apply for that has a different start time. So once again, wide variety of elementary start times. And then if they're not selected at any of those schools, we will work with JCTA on overstaffs to say, let's pair that teacher with a school. If they just absolutely cannot make it work, let's get them in a spot they can work. It's not good news, but I guess silver lining, we have plenty of vacancies right now that we can find places for teachers to place them in spots where the time will work for them. No, the application schools are not, but the transfer window, the student transfer applications begin on May 1st. So we will honor that with families who just can't do that start time. So they will have an opportunity to address that. If they've chosen one that just does not work for them, then we will work with them at the May 1st start of the student transfer window. Last call. Thanks, guys. Appreciate your time.